Okay, good morning everyone. I would like to start by thanking the organizers for the opportunity to be here, participate in the conference and report on this work. So I will base my talk on work with students in Madrid, Miguel Montero, Irene Valenzuela and Ander Retolaza, who are there in the audience, and also with Alex Westphal, who is in Aspen at the moment. The plan of the talk is to start with some motivation. Then I will move on to discussing the issue of transbranchian axion decay constants and how it interplays with possible constraints on quantum gravity. And then I will move on to a different topic, which is kind of related, which is transbranchian, not decay constants, but field ranges in axion monodromy models. And I will, in particular, discuss a late twist on an early models of this kind. And I will just conclude. So the motivation for this work is that there is a great interest in thinking about scalars rolling throughout the transplanckian field ranges in field space. And most of this motivation came obviously from the unclaimed result of the Bicep experiment regarding gravitational waves during inflation. So it's motivated by the slow roll of single fields during inflation in models which have a sizable ratio of tensor to scalar perturbations. But in general, this is a general question of consistency in quantum gravity of this kind of transplanckian field ranges. So I will focus on axion models, basically because we want to think about the scalars which have a transplanckian field range, but still have a subplanckian energy density accumulated in the potential. And axions are a good candidate to do so, because in general, we will think about models without supersymmetry. And in the absence of supersymmetry, it is useful to think about other possible symmetries that can protect your potential against the Planckian corrections. So the axions are periodic scalars, which have a perturbative shift symmetry, which prevents the appearance of perturbative derivative couplings, and in fact, potentials as well. And this continuous shift symmetry is broken to a discrete one, which is just the periodicity, by effects of which can be of possible two kinds. The first one is non-perturbative effects, and these kind of models fall in the class known as natural inflation models, or extranatural, or other things like that. And the second class of effects could be a monodromic effect, like those in these kind of axion monodromy models that I will discuss towards the end. So the models of natural inflation correspond to thinking about models with, let's say, single axion, and to consider that there are some instanton effects which break the continuous symmetry to some discrete subgroup. So if you think about the simplest model proposed by these people, like one instanton effects, basically you get this kind of cosine or trigonometric potential with some periodicity which is fixed by F, which is called the axion decay constant or axion periodicity. Now if you want to think about transplanckian field ranges, or in this kind of model you have to think about transplanckian Fs, and these are problematic to achieve in string theory as observed by Banks and collaborators. Typically if you try to build such or to achieve such values of F in any compactification, you're pushed to the edge of controllability in that kind of a compactification. And this is in fact a reflection of a feature of quantum gravity, as we will discuss later on. This was an effect first observed in this single axion model, but so to avoid it, there have been several proposals by including multiple axions. These are the models of N-flation, in which basically you have many axion scalars and you just move throughout along the diagonal of the hypercube. Kinetic alignment, in which you use the kinetic term of the axions to just privilege some direction, which you can try to make a transplanckian. Or lattice alignment, in which basically out of your non-perturbative effects, you align your instantons in such a way that there is some seemingly very flat direction which can reach the transplanckian regime. So what we did in this work with Montero and Valenzuela is to study what kind of gravitational effects you could have in these theories that potentially could spoil these transplanckian axion decay constants, these transplanckian field ranges. And the way to do it was to consider solutions of general relativity plus axions. These are gravitational instantons with some charge n with respect to the axions. So in a string theory, you can think about these effects as some effective description of Debrayne instantons, which couple precisely in the same way. And in fact, the kind of axion that you get for this gravitational instantons is just proportional to the charge times some numerical value related to the Planck scale and to the axion decay constant. So basically, this kind of instantons spoil the transplanckian field range or the transplanckian periodicity, basically because they induce a higher harmonics in your trigonometric potential. So on top of the cosine potential, if you make this F very large, there are contributions from instantons of higher end, which still have a very low action, and that contribute higher harmonics to your potential, effectively reducing the achievable field range, and therefore spoiling this model of inflation with large tensor to a scalar ratio, for instance. So, this result is consistent with a weak gravity conjecture of NEMA, Kumbrun, and other collaborators that we will revisit later on. Before that, we applied this gravitational instanton analysis to models with multiple actions to see how they behave and whether they are excluded as well or not. So you have to consider solutions of general relativity coupled to several actions, and then they couple with some charge vector n to all the actions of the theory. In this case, the action of the of the instanton is just proportional to the Planck scale, and then some kind of norm in charge space with some metric which is fixed by the kinetic matrix of the actions. To check whether there are higher harmonics that spoil the flatness of your potential, what you have to do is to check whether there are points in charge space, points in the lattice of charges, inside the ellipse defined by this quadratic form, inside the ellipse which corresponds to having a small action. Okay? So these are the results for several models. Inflation models seem to be fine at the level of these gravitational instantons. Kinetic alignment moment models are also fine, but lattice alignment moments are excluded because there are many, in general, when you align your vectors such that the field range becomes parametrically larger than the Planck scale, there are many points corresponding to many instantons that come into the dangerous regime and induce higher harmonics. In any event, it's important to notice that even though these models here seem to be okay, they are okay with respect to the kind of effect that we were looking at, which corresponds to gravitational instantons, which are just a subset of all the quantum gravity effects that there may be. And in particular, they are reliable only for large values of n, large charges, where they are semi-classical. So the absence of this kind of Euclidean wormholes or gravitational instantons is a necessary condition for the models to work. It's not sufficient. So to really go beyond that, there have been several works based on applying the weak gravity conjecture that I will sketch in just a slide. Basically, this conjecture appeared in the discussion of whether any model of effective field theory lies in the Swanplan or it is realized as a model in the string landscape. And the statement in some particular frame can be described as saying that in theories with quantum gravity with some U1, with a single U1, let's say, can be generalized to several, there must exist a particle in the spectrum with a low enough mass to charge ratio, or large enough charge to mass ratio. So the strong form means that this particularly light particle is the one that corresponds, that the particle that has a larger charge over mass ratio is the lightest one, and the mild form is that such particle has to exist, but it may not be the lightest one. And there is some debate about whether string theory satisfies one or the other form of this conjecture. So basically, this weak gravity conjecture, which was formulated for gauge fields, can be generalized, as they did in this same paper, to arbitrary p-form fields, and in particular, you can think about applying it to zero forms, that is, to actions. In the regarding actions, the statement would be that in quantum gravity with a single action, there is always an instanton with a low enough action, which is the result that we had already seen in terms of these gravitational instantons. In the strong form of the conjecture, the dominant instanton would be the one that induces higher harmonics, dominant in the sense that it has lowest action, so it contributes more to the potential. In the mild form, it means that there are instantons inducing high harmonics, but that there could be subdominant with respect to instantons generating the lower harmonics. Okay, so the strong form, the bottom line, is that the strong form of the conjecture is very constraining for multi-action models and basically rules out all of them, basically. So this has been a field of vigorous activities in the last, couple of months or so, with many contributions, and I will just give a sketch of how they work. So if you generalize to several actions, the weak gravity conjecture says that if you draw the polygon of vectors of charges with respect to the ratios of charge to the action, this must contain the unit ball in Planck units, of course. So in models of inflation, what you see is that if you have two actions, for instance, and if you look at the directions along the vertical or horizontal axis, the points here are fine, satisfy the weak gravity conjecture, in the sense that the instantons that satisfy the weak gravity conjecture don't spoil the potential, but there are other directions here in which this ratio is not large enough and you're inside the ball, and that means that you're not satisfying the conjecture in that case. In other models, the picture is more or less like that. There are, again, points or directions in which you are safe, but there are other directions in which, in the strong form of the conjecture, you do not satisfy it. So basically, the lesson is that if you believe the strong form of the conjecture, all these models are ruled out. So the models that achieve Transplanckian field range don't satisfy the strong form of the conjecture, and the only way to save them is to assume or to believe that it is only the mild form of the conjecture which is safe, and then there are other instantons somewhere else that exist, satisfy the conjecture, but they are subdominant with respect to the potential. So if a string theory satisfies the strong version, then this is very constraining, and all these natural inflation-like models will be ruled out. All the compactifications that have been looked at satisfy this strong form, so the open challenge now is to show that whether string theory does not satisfy the strong version, and then in such case, and if there are enough suppression factors for the instantons with minimal charge, then you could be able to realize this Transplanckian natural inflation. But this is still an open question, and hope to be reported to in the future. So instead, let me move to another scenario involving actions and provides a new attempt to achieve Transplanckian field ranges, but with some subplanckian action periodicities. The trick is to use a multivalued potential, which has some monodromic properties, as proposed by Silvestri and Westphal. And the simplest toy model, perhaps, for this kind of behavior, where you have a potential with a multi-branched form, is to think about the theta angle in large M pure Jahn-Mills theory, non-supersymmetric pure Jahn-Mills theory, as studied by Witten, for instance, using holography, etc. So this is something which is interesting to point out, is that the potential is protected by a dual three-form gauge invariance. This is something that I studied in collaboration with Marchesano and Xu, and Fernando talked about this in the last string meeting last year in Princeton. And it's based also on ideas of Valli and collaborators about how the action of QCD could be dualized into some other formulation. The basic idea is that you can think about the theory of a three-form which has a gauge invariance like that, but which is spontaneously broken, if you wish, by the three-form eating up some two-form. So this is some kind of generalized Higgs mechanism for p-forms. In this kind of theory, with this gauge invariance, you can dualize it back eventually to some theory of a scalar, an axionic scalar, which has some quadratic potential. This is basically connecting with this description of Kalloper and Sorbo, who provided the effective field theory description for axion monodromy models. And basically, one can show this gauge invariance to protect this gauge potential, because any correction will not come as some arbitrary function of this scalar phi, but if you want to think about it, it should be not a function of C3 or C2, but rather of the gauge invariant field strength. Okay, there is an early model which realizes these ideas, which was proposed by Liam McAllister, Silverstein, Ivan in the audience, and Alex Westphal, which is basically proposing that the action, which will inflate, etc., is obtained by taking some higher dimensional form, like a two-form, the Ramon-Ramon two-form in type 2B theory, and compactifying it over a two-cycle. This would lead to a flat potential, but you can introduce a monodromic potential by wrapping brain-anti-brain pairs on two homologous two-cycles, such that when you shift the scalar by some period, basically you change the induced D-brain charge, D3 brain charge on your D5 brains. And to prevent that these brain and anti-brains annihilate, you can separate them in internal space, and in fact you can put them down some warp throats to prevent them from coming close to each other. Now, Conlon pointed out that in these setups with brains and anti-brains, there is a logarithmic back reaction of one onto the other via exchange not of back modes, but of modes associated to the wrapped two cycle, just because there is this three chain connecting them, and there are some fields that can propagate throughout them. But this back reaction was proposed to be made negligible by putting the whole system of the two brains down the third brain, let me call it the overall brain, like that. So this would be a model which would be successful, and certainly it looks very ugly. Okay, so this bifid throat looks very ugly, but the point I want to make, and that we emphasize in this paper, is that this kind of geometries can be hosted by very simple setups, in fact, very simple local toric geometries, And in fact, given that there is some overall throat structure for this thing, one can think about proposing a holographic dual for these theories, which is something that we did. And you can analyze the process of monodromy and generation of the potential in terms of this holographically dual field theory. I will sketch that in the remaining of the talk. So let me start by discussing these simple geometries which host this bifid throat, this complicated throat structure. So let's start by recalling the basic throat, which is the Klebanov-Strassler one based on the conifold. So these are the web diagrams, which are dual to the toric diagrams that describe this conifold geometry. This corresponds to the resolved conifold with a finite size two cycle. And after the deformation, after the conifold transition, this corresponds to taking these two subwebs in the web diagram and separating them in some third direction. The geometry becomes non-toric, so you're removing some directions out of the plane. Basically, that's associated to the appearance of a three cycle in the geometry. And the appearance of this three cycle can be dressed with fluxes, etc., to provide the full geometry of the throat. To do it properly, the only thing you have to do is to wrap a number of fractional brains on these two cycles and let them back react and carry out the geometric transition to provide with this picture. So to do the same kind of thing with the bifid throat, the only thing you need is geometries which admit more cycles. Okay? So we need the throats which have three different cycles, one to support fluxes for this throat, another to support this throat, and another to support this throat. And then you need some two cycle to be in the geometry in such a way that it falls through the two throats here. So a simple geometry doing that corresponds to this web diagram where I have already separated this, I have done the complex deformations corresponding to the three cycles. And this and this two, the two cycle here, this curve of two cycles corresponds to a curve of A1 singularities in the geometry. So this geometry maybe look complicated, but it's just a set 6 or set 2 times set 3 orbifold of the conifold. You can think about it as some weird generalized conifold theory. Now, to construct the holographic dual of this bifid throat, what you have to do is to consider what kind of theory you get when you put D3 brains and fractional D5 brains at the toric singularity that corresponds to this orbifold of the conifold. And then the field theory on these difference is very easy to construct, basically because the geometry is toric, and you can use these dimer diagram techniques to construct the gauge theory. So this is the result. This is the web diagram, so this is the singularity in the resolve phase. Going to the deform phase corresponds to the picture I had before. This is the toric diagram, and this is the field theory that you get in a, drawn in a particular way. So basically there are 12 gauge factors, and each edge separating two gauge factors corresponds to a chiral multiplying the bifundamental, transforming under both factors. And the nodes here, black and white, correspond to some superpotential terms, which are not, I mean, can be read explicitly from the picture, but are not relevant at this point. So this explicit description allows for a completely explicit choice of the fractional brains that you have to introduce here, fractional D5 brains that you have to introduce in the geometry, such that when they back react and you do the geometric transition, what you find is precisely the supergravity configuration corresponding to this bifid throat. So in this field theory, you can study the RG flow that corresponds to the bifid throat. So I will just sketch some of the main steps that correspond to the RG flow in the throat. Let me just come back to this picture. Okay, so the RG flow will go in this direction, and we will just describe the main important events in the history of this theory as it evolves to the infrared. Okay, so the UV of the overall throat corresponds to a cyber duality cascade, in which this field theory with some fractional brains experiences a periodic cascade of cyber dualities in which the number of regular brains or the number of D3 brains reduces and the number of fractional brains stays. So because the number of regular brains decreases, eventually you run out of brains and you experience a different phenomena. Basically what happens, similar to what happened in Klebanov-Strassler, some of the gauge factors in this theory confine and they lead to some deformation of the moduli space. And that you can study explicitly the non-trivial strong dynamics of this theory at the end of the cascade and realize that it becomes this other theory, which is described by a new quiver, and this corresponds, in the language of toric geometry, to doing one complex deformation of this theory to this other one. We have grown a three cycle supported by fluxes, and that's the end of the overall throat. We can go to the next step, which corresponds to separating the two daughter throats. This is done in the field theory by some Higgs mechanism in which the theory suddenly realizes that there are some non-trivial BEPs at some scale, and these BEPs are such that the theory decouples into different gauge sectors which are independent and correspond to these pictures here, and they correspond to two different web diagrams of this form and this form, And this provide the UV of the daughter throats. This gauge theory suffered their own cascade of cyber dualities. They reached the infrared where the number of D3 bands is exhausted. And when you reach this infrared, there is some deformation to just this curve of A1 singularities. These cascades are very simple. They're just set to orbifold of the Klebanov-Stassler throat. And now in this theory that I sketch in this RG flow, you can study what's the field theory interpretation of the log back reaction of the brain and antibrains, et cetera, et cetera. Basically, they correspond to the RG evolution of gauge couplings, which is also logarithmic, as you expect in four dimensions. And this is something that had already been studied from the point of view of supergravity by Granja and Polchinski, and they studied in detail what's the effect of having this kind of fractional brains, what's the effect on the warp factor, and whether this is relevant or not. This would take, let me just mention a possible caveat, this discussion of Granja and Polchinski and the log-back reaction takes into account the issue of the fibrin antifibrin charge, but it doesn't take into account the possible back reaction of the D3 or anti-D3 brain tension, which is generated throughout the monodromy. And just for completeness, let me mention that clearly there is a debate about whether there is consistency in the treatment of antibrains in warp throats. So let me just mention that this could be possible caveat for this kind of models. But at least the main issues that appear due to the monodromy and the fibrins and the complicated geometries can be taken care of with this gravity dual. Let me just turn to the conclusions. Regarding transplanckian action decay constants or transplanckian field ranges in action monodromy, for the transplanckian action decay constants, it's pretty clear that they are constrained by quantum gravity, and there is some debate to what extent this is true and whether one can find at least some counterexamples of that. For the moment, all models that kind of try to achieve or seem to achieve this transplanckian action decay constant, they are at the edge of parametric control or beyond it. So the challenge at the moment is to realize models which may satisfy the mild but not the strong version of the weak gravity conjecture, and in those models there could be a chance of achieving these field ranges. But this is again an open issue. Concerning the transplanckian field ranges in action monodromy, I have emphasized that in these kind of setups, there are many protections due to the beautiful dual gauge symmetry. And I have discussed one particular point, let's say a late twist on an early model, which is the construction of the holographic dual of these bifid throats in the hope that one can make them a bit nicer. So clearly more work is needed. As I mentioned at the beginning, this is important just from the first principles perspective of just understanding these kind of field ranges in quantum gravity. But hopefully, and the recent developments in cosmology, hopefully this may be something relevant for just cosmological data or data related to nature. Thank you.
Juan?
Yeah, so in your talk you mentioned the gravitational instantons. If I understand correctly, these are the Giddings-Strominger wormholes.
Yes.
Right? But you were considering them in the case that the action was very small or F was very large, much bigger than M Planck. And then the charge one instanton would be subplanckian in size.
Yes.
Right? So then you cannot really trust them.
Yeah, for sure we trust these instantons just for large N. But I mean, in this, for instance, in inflation model, you try to make F parametrically larger than the Planck scale. And then there could be large instantons which contribute.
Yeah, I understand. So that, but then in order to see whether they are relevant phenomenologically, I think you need to know how big N needs to be in order for you to trust it.
Yes.
And so then you need to know whether the throat is size M Planck or 10
yes.
M Planck and so on. And depending on what numbers you put there, large field inflation is possible or it's not possible.
I agree.
I think we need to understand this.
Yeah, for sure.
Better.
The important point perhaps is that these gravitational instantons are just some effective description of something more microscopic. And in concrete setups like string theory, you can look for those effects. And you could construct like the precise D-brain instantons that correspond to this thing. And one can see that typically exist and spoil a large field inflation, at least in the simplest models.
Yeah, I agree. In a string theory model, you can find actual instantons that will spoil these potentials.
Yes.
But I guess in order to have an argument that certain values of R are not possible, we need It would be nicer to understand it from a low energy point of view.
I agree, and that's in a sense why we took this Pullman approach of just working with effective theory and the gravitational instantons, which is something that exists just in the effective theory. Of course, this very often you end up at the edge of controllability of effective field theory, and then the alternative has been to accept this weak gravity conjecture as something that comes from the UV and then to use it, which is what has been done in these other works. Clearly, both all approaches are complementary and should converge to some concrete answer, hopefully pretty soon.
Other question, Eva?
Yeah, so, I mean, another thing that's related to the axion evolution, aside from the instantons, is potentially non-adiabatic effects coming from not Euclidean wrapped brains, if you want, which give instantons, but wrapped brains that give particles or strings or other defects. So one question I have is this, has this played a role in this weak gravity story? I think it's something interesting for the phenomenology.
I say that it has not yet played an important role, but it is, we're getting to that point, I think. So people are looking for other effects and things that may be coming down from the UV down to the effective theory and may affect the process of inflation or achieving these Transprankian field ranges.
So another question / comment is, in the, you mentioned this old ugly example which you have beautified in some ways, but one of the reasons it was ugly was that at the time we were not allowing the back reaction to just, you know, give moduli adjustments that in some cases we now understand perfectly well can, it depends on the case, but it can adjust in such a way that it just flattens the potential further, because that's an energetically favorable possibility. So I've always wondered in that old setup whether in the end that would be the direction that it goes. So for example, would it just be a potential that's a little bit less than linear or not? And have you thought about that in your new construction?
Not in detail, but let me just mention that since this early model that was proposed, there have been many realizations of axion monodromy using not just brains but other ingredients, and I think it's pretty clear that in many of them the back reaction will not be relevant because it comes in a different way, not because of brain antibrains or things like that, but just because of the I don't know, moduli potential or things like that, which is something very tractable. So
okay, we have time for one or two here, please.
So the bottom line, if I understood correctly, is that an axion model doesn't work, but axion monodromy works, is that
so far? Okay, so there are many attempts to destroy it as well. And there was a recent paper suggesting things in that direction. But I would say that axion monodromy models may be wrong, but for different reasons, in the sense that they're not spoiled by the same kind of instantons that kill the single axion models or the natural inflation models. There may be other effects. I mean, they are related to the fact that once you wind around more and more times, there are things that come down below your cutoff. And it's not clear that they destroy the potential or things like that. So there may be things in the direction of what Eva was saying, that maybe they just modify a little bit the potential, or they lead to particle production or something which is not dangerous for the rolling of the scalar. So axion monodromy models, I would say, work so far, and we have to be watchful.
Sorry, just since it's come up, I mean, there are two ways in which fields enter the low energy theory in axion monodromy, at least. One is sectors that are periodic, they undergo monodromy, but they're periodic.
Mm-hmm.
That can lead to particle production effects. Those don't destroy inflation. If anything, they help slow down the field, and I think there's interesting phenomenology to mm-hmm. do with how they lead to oscillatory phenomena on the power spectrum and beyond. But the other thing you mentioned is sectors which become light as you go out in field range, not periodically.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, as you know, in these explicit constructions, those degrees of freedom have been taken into account and their effects have been estimated to not, you know, get in the way of the super Planckian range.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, any attempt at a no-go theorem based on strong, weak gravity, et cetera, would have to address those estimates directly.
I agree. There is a lot of knowledge from the UV in string theory, and the models seem to work so far.
Okay, one last question.
Yeah, so you've mentioned both the mild and the strong forms of the weak gravity conjecture, and I'm wondering, do you have any reasoning for why the strong form should be true?
No, I don't. I think it's a matter of letting the theory tell us.
Okay, so let's thank Anil for a very nice talk.